Good morning. Man, what a good-looking crowd this morning. I see a lot of our people that usually come to 8 o'clock are here, and then we have the people that usually come to 10:30, and you can switch up any service you want. But this morning, we had our Easter breakfast at 8 o'clock, so I know a lot of people, we didn't have an 8 o'clock service, so a lot of people have come to the 10:30, and we appreciate everybody being here. The Lord's given us just a certain amount of place to worship in, but it never needs to be a deterrent where you say, well, I'm going to have to sit closer, it's going to be crowded, because that shouldn't bother us. We came here to worship, so the closer we are, the better it's going to work for the way the Lord wants us to worship, right? So I appreciate you being here today. I want to welcome all the visitors, and I do want to tell you that we have a visitor's card that you can fill out and tear off and send in. It's in the bulletin. It's part of your bulletin. It's on this back page, so we want you to fill it out so that we'll know who you are, and if you want to communicate with the church, we'll be glad to. But I just want to thank you for being here. And then I've got a couple of praises. First of all, last Sunday night, how many people were able to come to the movie last Sunday night, the Billy Graham movie? What a blessing it was. And just to give God all the praise, we were able to see 6 people accept the Lord as their Savior last Sunday night. So what a huge praise that is to know that the kingdom's changed. So we just praise God for that. And then this morning, of course, the breakfast, that was a praise just to be able to fellowship and everybody be together this morning. And then tonight, we have a lot to look forward to because we have our Easter cantata tonight, and our choir is going to be singing, so we want you to come back at 6 and enjoy that. I know that you'll be blessed. As far as announcements go, on the same note, the choir needs to be here at 4 today, so they're going to be practicing and going through in preparation, so choir, be here at 4. And then there's an announcement in your bulletin about the children's choir. The rehearsals are going to resume on April the 12th. So Vicki says they still have open parts for the musical and would love to have your children's participation. So the children need to be memorizing their parts and scenes. And so look in your bulletin for those announcements. And then today at 5 o'clock, if you are a parent of a kindergarten through 5th grade, we have a children's summer camp meeting today. It's at 5 o'clock upstairs, so we want you to be there for that. It's in the last class on the left, last classroom on the left. So if your kid has been to camp and it's changed their life, let me ask you this. Parents who have children who have been to camp before and that child has either made a profession of faith or their life has changed, will you raise your hand in here this morning? Amen. Amen. That's awesome. So you can see that's something you want your child to go to. So be at the meeting today. It's at 5 o'clock. It says the deposit of $40 is due at the meeting. Just to be able to know how many people are going. So please have your child there or you be there. And then senior adults, you're going to meet April the 9th at 11:45 at the church to go to the Meadows in Rockwell. So mark that on your calendar. And then know that our Easter schedule, of course, the cantata tonight, but Easter Sunday is next Sunday. We will not have any evening services next Sunday, but we will have both morning services. And then you see some youth news that's in there, things that are coming up this week, so pay attention to that. Pay attention if you have children that this upcoming Saturday we will have our resurrection egg hunt. Yes, that's the resurrection egg hunt. It comes complete with a sermon on for the children to be able to know what we're celebrating when we go and look for those eggs. So please, if anyone is interested in helping with the egg hunt, which means that you need to be able to help hide the eggs, please be here at 8:30 this upcoming Saturday, and we could use all the help that we can get. So any other announcements that we have? Anybody? Then as far as prayer requests go, continue to remember Bob Lohman and Jeff Earnhardt and Nancy Lynn and Chloe Monroe, Grady Morris, Barbara Gentle, Wendy Maynard, and Gene Poplin. All of those who are battling cancer and leukemia, they're going through treatments right now. Please be lifting them up. Also Linda Binge, who's recovering from surgery. Carol Starnes, who is recovering from surgery. And then Karen Webb, which I see Karen here this morning. Praise God, sister. It's good to see you back, but Karen's recovering too, so be praying for her. Danny Carlisle had another surgery this week, and he is at Presbyterian. He does have pancreatitis, so please be praying for Danny. He'll be there a while just battling that if you know anything about it, so please be lifting him up in prayer. Be lifting up Kendall Ferguson in prayer. She had a heart cath this week, and so she is still on the transplant waiting list, so please be praying for her. And then also, some of you received the email this week. I announced Wednesday night that Scott and Amanda Fortin had baby Joshua, and I was giving you all the details, and they found out Wednesday evening that something was going on, and they checked, and realized that his esophagus was not attached to his stomach. So it's a problem that they're going to have to surgically repair. They have been at Northeast since then, but they transferred the baby last night, baby Joshua, to CMC at Levine's. That surgery will be in the morning where they'll try to reattach the esophagus. And so be lifting that family up in prayer. He was about 3.5 weeks early with that going on internally. As a parent, I have to just applaud Scott and Amanda for just having that strong faith, but be lifting them up during this time. Always hard to see your children going through that, so be praying for them. And they also wanted me to thank you for your prayers. Also, if you would, just pray for the service today. And if you have a prayer request that you want to mention by raising your hand, please lift your hand. The Lord sees our hands, and we'll pray together. Father, we love you so much and are so thankful that you've given us this time to worship. We thank you, Lord, for your mercy and your grace and just the availability of this place and the freedom to come and worship. We thank you, God, for the physical ability that you've given each one of us to be here today. And Lord, we never want to take that for granted. And you've heard all the prayer requests that were mentioned by the hands that were raised. You've seen those. Lord, you've heard what we've mentioned as far as those that are battling cancer, leukemia, those that are facing surgery, those that are recovering from surgery. We just pray, God, that you would just minister your healing touch according to your precious will. We know, God, and trust in your perfect will, and we accept whatever it is, but we just pray, God, for that healing. We pray for those that are going through emotionally hard times, that are mourning or grieving. We just pray, God, that you would give them that strength. And then, Lord, this morning, as we've gathered here, and Lord, we begin to list the things that we need for, Lord, the thing that we need most is just that fellowship with you, that closer walk with you. So we just ask you, Lord, this morning to meet in this place, that as we begin to lift our voice in song, that you would just fill this place with your Spirit. If there's anyone here that's never accepted your Son Jesus as their Savior, they would see their need for salvation today. They would see that there's not another second that they could wait. And Lord, we pray for all of us that we would just leave here today with more knowledge of you and closer to you, Lord, so that we could go out and serve you better. We just thank you for this another time to worship. We give this service to you and ask you, Lord, even now, just to remove the distractions that we have in our mind. Let us be able to focus on you and you alone. Everything you do, we'll love you, praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Are you guys ready to worship this morning? If you are, please stand. Greg's going to come and lead us.
Good morning. Good morning. We'll change it up this morning. Go ahead and start us up, Dale.
Is a God.
Back it up. The beginning would be good. Back it up, the beginning, please. Always better to start at the beginning. There we go. Words and music by Chris Tomlin. Let me hear you cry out this morning. How great is our God? Here you go. The splendor of the King.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice.
He wrapped himself
in light
and darkness,
and darkness tries to hide and trembles at his voice. Trembles at his voice.
How great is our God?
How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God.
How great grace in the name above all names this morning. And you cry out,
name above all names, and worthy of all praise. My heart will sing how great is our God.
Ronnie, will you sing it with me? Name above all names.
Name
God's people said. Amen. Take 2 minutes, tell your neighbor good morning. Tell them how great your God is this morning. Return to your seats. We'll continue in worship. sing this great hymn, Because He Lives. Here you go.
God sent His Son.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank You for this beautiful day. Lord, we thank You for this place of worship, Lord, where we can come in and learn Your Word. Lord, we just pray that You'll help us not to forget the meaning of Easter, Lord. Lord, that You sent your son to die on that cross and to be resurrected again. Lord, in the blood that was shed on that cross, Lord, so we have that relationship with you and to be able to have that everlasting life. Lord, like the song says, Lord, because he lives, we can face tomorrow. Dear Lord, we just lift Pastor Mike up, Lord, as he brings the message today. Lord, we pray that you'll be with him. Lord, we just pray that if there's one here today, Lord, that doesn't know you, Lord, we pray that today is the day that, Lord, you just speak to them, Lord, and they answer that call. Dear Lord, we lift each and every one up on our prayer list, Lord. Lord, we pray that you'll comfort them, heal them if you see fit. Dear Lord, we love you. We thank you for your mercy and your grace, Lord. Lord, we pray all this in your precious and holy name. Amen.
Joy we've never known before. The life of Jesus Christ. Stand with me and let's continue praising this morning. Sing in the garden with me. We'll sing three verses this morning. Father, we thank you for the blessings of eternal life promised us through your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for the many blessings you share with us each and every day. As we take a moment to give back a small portion of those blessings to the glory of your kingdom, bless each gift and giver, and bless all that we give, that it may bring you honor and glory. Be with Mike as he leads us this morning. Fill him with your presence. Fill him with the spirit that you would have poured out on us so that we can be better servants for you. All these things we ask in your son's precious and holy name. Amen.
I'm going to ask all the young people, if they would, to come forward this morning. Guys, how's everybody doing?
Good.
Come on down this way. Good. It's good to see everybody. We'll let everybody get in here. You know what I have here this morning? Does anybody know what this is?
Palms.
Why do I even have palms today?
Because it's Palm Sunday.
No, it's not. Is it?
Yes.
Today?
Yes.
I thought that was next. Is it today really?
Yes.
Oh, it's a good thing I have them then, right? Yes. Palm Sunday. Does anybody know what Palm Sunday stands for? Why we celebrate Palm Sunday? Anybody? Why?
Jesus.
What about him? He rode into town on a donkey on Palm Sunday, didn't he? And what were they saying to him? Somebody tell me. Huh? No. What were they saying to him? Hosanna, right? Hosanna. They're saying, save us, save us. They were looking at Jesus as being the king that was coming. He was riding on a donkey. So I'm going to give you these palm branches this morning so that you can be able, when you get through, I'm going to give them to you and you can take them home with you. Tell you what, if you're going to children's church, you can be able to give them to your parents. And if you're going to children's church, you can give them to Miss Angie and she'll give them back to you at the end of it. But that way, don't forget to remind me to give these to you, okay? Who's going to remind me? All of you? All right. I'll give them to you afterwards, but I don't want you playing with them during service, okay? And smacking each other and waving and fanning. And don't give them to any adults because they're the ones that's probably going to do that kind of thing. Keep them away from the adults, all right? All right, so remind me to do that. So Palm Sunday, what is so good about Jesus riding in the town on a donkey? Where was he on the way to? Do you know where he was going to be a week from then? What happened? He got what? He died on the cross, right? So he went from riding into town on Palm Sunday to dying on the cross. Well, he did ride on a donkey. And he rode into town, and that's what kings rode on. But listen, how does dying on the cross, how does that make you strong enough to be a king? Does anybody know? Who knows? Who knows anything about being strong in here? Does anybody know anything about being strong? Anybody? Jacob, you know anything about being strong? You have muscles, right? Now, how would you show somebody that you were strong, Jacob? If you had to test your strength, how would you show them? You could pick up a 30-pound weight. You could arm wrestle, exactly. Look, I got a table right here, Jacob. Come on up. We're going to arm wrestle, all right? Now, listen. Now, this is going to show who's got the most power. Hop right over here, Jacob, on this side. Who's got the most power? Now, who do you think you should arm wrestle? You want him to arm wrestle me?
Yeah.
All right, so I'm going to arm wrestle Jacob, okay? And we're going to see who's got the most power. Now, how do you know who will have the most power? Somebody tell me. Somebody tell me. How do you know who will have the most power when we get through? Whoever does what? Whoever puts the other person's down. So do you feel like if I'm stronger, I'm going to be able to put his hand down, right? And if he's stronger, he's going to be able to do it, right? All right, well, what if I just chose one of these young men on the front row there? Do you think they're strong enough to do it?
Yeah.
Are they? All right, I'm going to arm wrestle Jacob, and then we'll see about all those ones that aren't looking at me. Those right there. All right? Look, well, first we'll get with Jacob, and then we're going to try to find something, because who do y'all feel like's going to win? Why do you think I'm going to win?
Because you're bigger.
Strong? How do you know? We haven't even done this yet. I am a little bigger, right? All right. All right, you ready? Not that hand. You just picked that one. That one. Did you see that?
I scratched my nose, not picked.
It's your secret weapon. Huh?
Oh, gosh.
All right. Now, somebody's going to have to say go. I'm going to get down on one knee. Somebody's going to have to say go. Hold on. Whoa, hold on a second. All right, you ready? On your mark, get set, go. Are y'all cheering for him or me or who? Did you hear what she said? She takes everything she said back. Do you know why? Guess who won? Does that mean that he has more power?
Yeah.
Guess what? You see, it does. And put your arm back down here, Jacob. See, Jacob, go, Jacob, go. Jacob doesn't have more power. See, you know what took the most power?
Yeah.
I knew that if I let him win, that I had to be able to face anybody's criticism. I had to be able to face anybody saying, you're weak and he's more powerful. Do you know that takes a lot more power to let somebody else win, doesn't it? Now, do you know what Jesus did for you? You know what he did for you? When he hung on the cross, do you think he could have come down off of that cross if he wanted to? Absolutely. He could have called thousands of angels to take him off that cross. And God had more power in Jesus Christ. He had the power to come off that cross. But just like this, he let them crucify him. You know why he let them? Because his power was the power to love you and the power to love me. So the same way that I let Jacob be able to have the power to take me down, it was my power that just surrendered and submitted to let him do it, because I know he needed to win. Does that make sense? That's Jesus knew he had to be able to go through, and he had to let people be able to crucify him in order for you to be able to go to heaven. Now, whenever he rode into town on that donkey and those palm leaves, they put down and they said, Hosanna to the king. Do you realize they never realized that their king would die on a cross? But your king died on a cross. He didn't do the most powerful thing that you think as far as coming down off of that cross and killing all those soldiers. He chose to do the most powerful thing. Powerful as love is, to be able to stay on that cross. So when you have these palm leaves, you think about a king that rode into town that had the power to stay on the cross, not to come down, okay? All right, I want you to pray with me. Lord, I love you and I praise you and I thank you for these children. I ask you, Lord, to be able to just impart upon their mind, Lord, how much you love them, how much you went through to be able to see your son crucified on that cross. In Jesus' name, amen. Now I'm going to give you a couple of things today. So I don't want you to come up here all at once, okay? I want you to keep a little distance. Hold on a second. Now, you know, I've shown you before what I carry in my pocket, right?
No.
I carry this in my pocket. See what that is? There's a lot of men. How many men out here are packing today? If you're packing, hold that cross up in your hand. Stand up and hold it. Look at this. Watch this. Watch them hold that cross up. They carry that in their pocket. You see that? You know what that means? That means every time I look at it, it lets me know God loved me enough to let Jesus die on that cross. There's power in that cross. Not in this piece of metal, but there's power in what Jesus did on that cross. Okay, first of all, I'm going to give you, tell you what, Reggie's going to give you a cross as you go out. Reggie, if you could stand over there somewhere, way over there. And Blake's going to give you a palm, and I'm going to give you fruity snacks, all right? Parents, if your child is too little to have any of these things, please meet your child as soon as they come down from here so it won't be on me. There you go. Don't forget to go to Reggie and go to Blake and get, okay?
Thank you.
Here you go. Getting a lot of stuff today, aren't you?
Thank you.
You're welcome. You're welcome. There you go. Yeah, you have to be strong to lift up a brick.
Thank you.
You're welcome. You're welcome. Hey, buddy. How are you?
Appreciate it.
Yep. Need some more? I've got a couple. I've got more. How many people have your Bibles today? If you have your Bible, stand up and raise it above your head. You may be seated, please. Our text today is from the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 1. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. If you can turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, and when you find your place, say, I have it. We'll also be reading from Matthew chapter 27. 1 Corinthians 1, Matthew 27. We call this Sunday Palm Sunday, and whether this particular Sunday of the year actually represents the actual event that it described is not a point that we're going to investigate today. We are using the day to commemorate Jesus riding into Jerusalem on a donkey. If we read the story in Matthew chapter 21, it says, "And a very great multitude spread their garments in the way, and others cut down branches from trees and strawed them in the way. And the multitudes that went before and that followed cried, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." And we're familiar with that story. Jesus was being hailed by the crowd coming into Jerusalem as the Messiah. The Messiah that they had waited on, the Messiah that they've heard about for thousands of years. They believed this Messiah would be a man sent from God. They were shouting, Hosanna, which means save us. They were living under Roman rule and Roman oppression, so their idea of being saved was for someone to come in and deliver them out from under the hand of the Romans. They saw Jesus as the potential Messiah. Some of them did. The ones that were going before and the ones that were coming behind that were crying Hosanna. But understand, the Messiah, in their mind, was the person who would come and set up his powerful kingdom. And they thought of him as someone who had the power of God. And Jesus fit this because Jesus spent so many sermons talking about the kingdom of God, the kingdom of God. And if this is the Messiah, surely that's going to be his overwhelming message, the kingdom of God. Be a part of the kingdom of God. 54 verses in the book of Matthew, Jesus speaks of the kingdom of God. So you know, that's his agenda. But their idea of setting up a kingdom, well, it came with a logical reasoning. In other words, understand they were under Roman oppression. So in order for them to have a Messiah to come and free them, of course, in their mind, it means that Messiah would have to deliver them from under Roman oppression. So their Messiah would have to be someone who was strong and powerful and able to overthrow this other government. Jesus had preached so much about this kingdom, but still the people thought that their only means of salvation was for their Messiah, through the power of God, to overthrow the Roman Empire. So I make a point of this because it's going to come into being in our subject today. You see, Jesus had repeatedly told them that his kingdom was not of this world. He had tried to explain to them, and he was telling them that with his kingdom, he was offering something more than temporary freedom. He was offering eternal freedom. He was offering everlasting life. I draw back to the response that Jesus had to Pilate in John 18, where he answered Pilate and said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now is my kingdom not from hence." You see, this is important to know because people today still have the wrong idea about Jesus, the King. People today refuse to accept Him because they refuse to believe and accept what Jesus did for them to make sure that they could be a part of His kingdom and eternally free. Not just temporarily free from whatever has you oppressed, but eternally free. Eternally free from the punishment of eternal bondage and eternal death. You see, just as they were proclaiming Him as King and thinking that He was the answer to their oppressed life, they were faced with something that they found hard to believe. In other words, they had to believe in Him being a Messiah if they wanted to be delivered, but He just didn't. He didn't really fit the mold that they thought a Messiah should be. And you say, well, we're celebrating Palm Sunday. Didn't He come riding into town on a donkey and they were going before and going behind? Yes, yes, they did. There were so many people that thought, we've waited, this has got to be the man. He's done miracles, He's healed people. We've seen the things that He's done that we can't explain, so we know He has the power of God on Him. This has to be the man. So they hailed Him as King. And He rode into town. And don't think that everyone was recognizing Him as King, because He really didn't fit the part of a Messiah to all of the religious leaders, to the chief priests, to the scribes. Why? Well, they were the religious elite. And because Jesus was the son of a carpenter, he couldn't be the Messiah. But to these other common people, this had to be him. This had to be him. You say, well, what happened to all those people by the time he got to the cross? Well, that's what I want you to see today. There was a hurdle that those people that were laying the palms in the road, there was a hurdle that they could not get over. It was such a hurdle in their minds that they chose not to believe. And not only did they choose not to believe, they believed actually at the end that Jesus couldn't be the Messiah. Do you remember what they shouted as they stood outside of Pilate's gate? Somebody tell me. Again, what? And what were they shouting at Palm Sunday? Save us. Then crucify him. What happened in between? You see, the hurdle that they could not get over, the one hurdle, and it's our subject today. What was that hurdle? That hurdle was the cross. In all of their wisdom and all that they thought and all the prototypical picture that they had of what their Messiah would be, the cross never entered into the picture and everything that led up to the cross. You see, the cross and what it stands for is what man still struggles with today. The picture of the cross is not the way that man thinks that a king would show his power. But we'll see today that there is power in the cross. Power in the cross. I want you to turn to the person beside of you and I want you to tell that person there's power in the cross. Are you in 1 Corinthians chapter 1? As we explore the scripture today, we'll have an opportunity to see the power of the cross. And God has used Paul here in 1 Corinthians to explain to us that this power, the power of the cross and the sacrificial death of Jesus on that cross and the persecution and humiliation of Jesus leading up to that cross and the resurrection of Jesus after that death on the cross is the power that we have to use if we want to be freed from the bondage that we are now in. Everybody that knows that, that has claimed that, that is living by that, and has your eternal freedom banked on that, should have just shouted amen. That's your eternal freedom. Not a word was said. What's wrong with us? There's power in the cross. Paul was giving a message here. And the background of this message was that there was divisions in the church. There were some people in the church that claimed to follow Paul, some that claimed to follow Apollos, some that claimed to follow Peter. And the message here that he gave was a message of the power of the cross. He was trying to tell them that, hey, it makes no difference. You don't follow Paul, you don't follow Apollos, you don't follow Peter. We're unified by the one message of the cross. Verse 17 of 1 Corinthians chapter 1, we begin to read. It says, "For Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God." Did you hear that? Unto us that are saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, "I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and will bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent." Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this word? "Hath not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. For the Jews require a sign, and the Greeks seek after wisdom." Listen to verse 23 and 24. "But we preach Christ crucified, unto the Jews a stumbling block, and unto the Greeks foolishness. But unto them which are called both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. for ye see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called, but God hath chosen the foolish things of this world to confound the wise, and God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. This morning, the picture that you have and that the children have, we had in a children's sermon, as it would have been clear that if Jacob and I would have arm wrestled, the power that you thought I had to be able to defeat him was a sure thing. But at the end of the arm wrestling match, Jacob was able to put my arm down. And what was the one reason he was able to put my arm down? What was the one reason? Somebody tell me. Because I let him. Understand, it took more power to let him than it did to put him down. That would have been a physical strength. It took power that went beyond to be able to let him, and that's the whole theme. It's not a wisdom that man grasps onto, because man measures power in your ability to do something. As we explore this scripture today, we'll be able to see the power of the cross. In verse 17, Paul begins by saying, Christ sent me to preach the gospel. And Paul is saying in this whole canon of verses, I'm going to preach the gospel. I'm going to preach the cross of Christ. Why is this important for us to look at today? Do you realize that the message of the power of the cross is becoming obsolete in the local church today? In order to preach the cross, in order to preach Christ crucified, you have to be able to tell someone they're a sinner. You have to be able to tell someone that it requires them to accept something that they can't rightly, logically understand, and it requires faith. So a man would have to admit, number one, that he's weak, and number two, that he's too foolish to understand how it even works to even accept it. So today, since we live in a society where men see themselves as being intelligent and they don't want to admit that they're a sinner, then the cross of Christ is not a message that brings people in, is what they say. Paul said, and I'm going to take Paul's word for it. By the way, Paul, as far as his resume, was responsible for starting the New Testament church. So let's listen to him. What does he say, preach? He says, preach the gospel. Preach Christ. Preach Christ crucified. He said in verse 17, Christ sent me to preach the gospel. You say, what is the gospel? Did anybody say, what is the gospel? Listen to this. I've got it here for you. He said it again in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Listen to these verses. Pretty clear. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, by which also you are saved, if you keep in your memory what I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you, first of all, that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scripture, and that how that He was buried, and how that He rose again on the third day according to the Scriptures. You know what the gospel is? Jesus Christ, the sinless man, died as the atoning lamb. The lamb that had to be slain so that His blood could cover our sins. Jesus Christ buried as a man that had life that went out of him. And Jesus Christ resurrected by the hand of God. That's the gospel. The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. So we read here, and Paul said, that's what I'm going to preach. He was not preaching a progressive religion. He didn't have a feel-good message. He didn't have a tickle your ears, I'm not going to offend you. You're not really doing anything wrong. Let's all come together. Let's fellowship. Everybody can leave. Nobody has to change anything. Please come back. That was not Paul's message. He preached the gospel. He didn't have an agenda, an itinerary. He said, and this is unique to me, I think that we miss this. He said, Christ sent me to preach the gospel. Christ sent me to preach the gospel. Verse 18, he says, for the preaching of the cross, and he gives us two different scenarios. The preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. Do you know that everyone who refuses the sacrificial death of Jesus on the cross will perish in hell? Listen to that. Everyone who refuses the sacrificial death of Jesus Christ on the cross will perish in hell. That's eternal death. These people who refuse to believe have put the sacrificial death of Jesus on the cross in a category in their mind called the foolish category. This means that they'll perish in hell. You say, well, you don't have to be so coarse about it. I'm trying to be direct. Understand that if someone has believed that it is foolish to accept Jesus Christ because there's got to be a more logical way to get to heaven. Maybe the logical way is doing good works. Maybe the logical way is to be a part of a church. Maybe the logical way is that my family has been such and such kind of family in the church. Or maybe the logical way is going through some kind of class that a church offers for a time, and all of a sudden they present you with a certificate that says, hey, you're fine. You're confirmed. You are everything that you need to be. You're going to heaven. Maybe that's the way. Because logic says I can learn enough. Logic says I can be good enough. But he's saying, listen, the people that refuse it, to them that perish, this way, the cross way, was foolishness to them. Basically, it means that everyone who has not believed the message of the cross, the gospel, has chosen to rely on their own wisdom to save them. But I want you to notice the second part of this verse. He says, but unto us which are saved, but unto us which are saved. How many people are saved? Unto us which are saved, it. I want you to say that word with me, it. Again. But unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. Now, do you know what the subject of this sentence was? The cross. But unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. The cross is the power of God. Everyone who accepts the message of the cross and believes in Jesus Christ's substitutionary death for them will experience the power of God to save their souls from hell. And it will give them a relationship with God that lasts forever. What he's saying is the cross as we know it, is a picture of the power of God on display. To save us, to save anyone who believes in it. The power is what saves us. In verse 19, Paul quotes Isaiah and says, and I paraphrase here, everyone who thinks that they're wise enough or intelligent enough to refuse the cross, all that knowledge that they have, how wise they think they are, will all be destroyed. Because they trusted in their own wisdom and intelligence. In other words, he says, their wisdom will prove to be nothing. As smart as you thought you were, what did you know? Nothing. The wisest men that refuse to believe in God's plan of salvation through the cross, all the wisdom they have in hell will not get them out of hell. It will not buy them 1 second back. It will prove to be nothing. He goes on in the next several verses, 20 through 22, and he says, where's the wise? Where's the scribe? Where's the disputer of the word? Do you know that man has never been able to figure out how God's created the world and everything in it? Amen. Where is the wise? Oh, well, you'll hear 3 or 4 versions of how somebody thinks it happens. Still trying to skip over the point of where you came up with the first Adam. A-T-O-M. How did you make something that was going to collide and have a big bang? Where did it come from? I'm telling you, it would take a further stretch for me to believe some of these principles of how they believe the world was created. Man wants to know, though. They want to conquer by knowledge. Man's never been able to figure out how God's sustained the earth. So if man sees himself to be so wise as to refuse what God says so that he can accept his own wisdom, then God is saying that the only people who can have fellowship with him and have eternal life in heaven are those people who are considered so foolish in this world that have accepted the gospel. How many people in here know that if you're a Christian, you will be considered foolish by those intellectually superior around you? If you don't believe it, just cut on one newscast, any major network, and you will see the mockery that's made out of what God says is right, and how naive and foolish the people are, us, that follow God, right? I can't believe in 2015 people still have this mindset. Oh, really? I have the mindset of the God that created you and gave you the breath to say that about my mindset, right? I'll be foolish until I spend eternity in heaven, if that's what it takes. So I want you to see here, he says in these verses in 22, he says the Jews are looking for a sign. They're looking for a Savior that looks like a Savior, as far as they can think a Savior should look and act. And the Greeks, they're looking for wisdom, something that makes logical sense to them, something that they can have approval in their mind of, something that they can wrap their wisdom around. So he's going to talk about these two groups here, but I want you to pay special attention to verses 23 and 24. We're going to see three different ways that man views the cross and the sacrificial death of Jesus. Hopefully we'll understand the power of the cross once we see these three different ways. What Paul is saying is, hey, listen, I'm that foolish preacher called Paul. Foolish enough to believe. And I'm going to tell you, Paul was probably one of the most intellectually superior people that was walking on the face of the earth as far as knowing about God and all facets of the God of the Old Testament. I want you to listen to verse 23 and 24. We'll read it together here. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. We'll hang this sermon on these verses. But we preach Christ crucified unto the Jews a stumbling block and unto the Greeks foolishness. But unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. I want to take a little time on these two verses because it gives us in these two verses three kinds of people, three reactions of people, three mindsets of people as far as the cross is concerned, and Jesus' sacrificial death on the cross. He begins in verse 23 by saying, but we preach Christ crucified. When he says we preach Christ crucified, this is Christ on the cross. Paul is saying, we preach Christ on the cross. What did Christ do on the cross? He died for our sins on the cross. He was a substitutionary lamb. In the Old Testament, there had to be a lamb, a perfect lamb, that was brought to make atonement for the sin of the man that brought it. And that lamb was taken, and the blood of that lamb is what was used. The throat of that lamb was cut, the blood was used, and the blood made atonement because the blood was where life was at. And that lamb sacrificed his life. And God saw that man had taken that most precious thing he had. So God said, that's your sacrifice. You gave me the most precious thing you had, so I'm going to forgive you. And that day, Jesus on that cross, preaching Christ on the cross, he was the Lamb of God, as John called him, behold, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. Jesus on that cross became that Lamb. Paul saying, that's what we preach, the death of Jesus Christ to take away our sins. I love, basically, 2 Corinthians, the 5th chapter of 2 Corinthians. In the 5th chapter of the book of 2 Corinthians, Paul gives a little concert, if you will, on man's reconciliation to God. How that God loved man so much he wanted to reconcile. That means he wanted to bring him and man together. We know when we begin to read verse 17, it says, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away, and behold, all things are become new. He begins talking about how if you're united with Christ, you become in God, you're reconciled to God. And he ends with verse 21 that says, for he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in Him. He hath made Him to be sin. He hath made who to be sin? Jesus. He made Jesus to be sin. Had Jesus ever sinned? No. Have you ever sinned? Have I ever sinned? You assume I have. Yes, I have. Plenty. Plenty. But Jesus took my judgment. God didn't say, Mike, bring your best lamb. He said, I'll give you my best thing. What a love. And when I finally realized that love, that's when it became real to me. Like the song says, at the cross where I first saw the light and the burden of my heart rolled away. When I realized God loved me enough to give His most precious thing to me, a light came on. That's where I saw the light. That's what He's saying. Preach the cross. Preach the blood of Christ. Preach the sacrificial death of Christ. Preach the atoning blood of Christ. That was His message. Why? Because the gospel, the cross, the message saves souls. If I were to tell you, how do you lead somebody to Christ? And I would say, well, let me tell you, first of all, you have to realize that you're a sinner. Romans 3:10, as it is written, there's none righteous, no, not one. Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That means I'm separated from God. What brings me together with God? Well, somebody had to go to the cross. Who went to the cross? So the cross is in the fact that I'm a sinner and I'm separated from God. If I wasn't a sinner, I wouldn't need the cross. Since I am a sinner, I do. Romans 6:23 tells me if I continue to think the way that I'm thinking and don't change my condition, the wages of sin is what? Death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. That gift that He gave you hung on a what? It's the power of the cross. When we go to John 3:16, we know that verse so good. For God so loved the world that He gave His Son on a cross. You say, that's not what it says. That's exactly what it says. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God so loved the world that He put His only Son that had never sinned, that had never disappointed, that had never done anything wrong, and He put Him on a cross as a gift and said, Mike, you sinner that can't save yourself, here's the gift. I'm going to put Him on a cross and let Him be the sacrifice on that altar. That's the gospel. All these verses point to the cross, His life for ours. Now, Paul's message is Christ crucified. He says in verse 23, we preach Christ crucified. This is the message of the power of the cross. But then he gives two groups of people that refuse this message. They refuse the message of the power of the cross. These two groups of people are the Jews and the Gentiles, or the Jews and the Greeks. Basically, this means if you say, well, who are the Greeks? It would be the Jews and everyone who's not a Jew. That's who he's speaking to. You either put yourself in a position of being born of Jewish descent or not born of Jewish descent. And the first people we talk about are the Jews. He says unto the Jews, the cross, Christ on the cross, is a stumbling block. So let's go back to Palm Sunday. Something had to happen between laying out the palms and shouting Hosanna to standing there and shouting crucify Him. What happened? The idea of the cross. It was a hurdle for them. That is not the way. The King that we've been waiting for is going to deliver us. He can't even deliver Himself. Not only do we not believe He's the Messiah, we believe there's no way He can be the Messiah. What would turn all those people celebrating in the street to be all the mob who was campaigning for His death? You see, he's saying in the wisdom of most of the Jews, the message of the power of the cross was a stumbling block. On their way to accepting that Messiah and coming close to God, They couldn't get to God because in their mind, they kept tripping over the cross. It's the same mentality that they had as they were celebrating Jesus as he rode into town on that donkey. You see, the Jews had a picture in their mind what they thought the Messiah would do. And so far, Jesus fit that description of being able to heal people and being able to walk on water and the loaves and the fish. And I mean, everything that he had done, this has got to be him. He had fit that description to all the people waving the palms. He didn't necessarily fit that description to those Pharisees and religious leaders, but by the end of the week, eventually by the end of the week, most all those Jews refused him as their Messiah because they believed that the power of God, if that was the Messiah, would have given this man Jesus strength over this Roman government. And the power of God would have given Jesus, if he was the Messiah, if he was the deliverer, the power of God would have kept the real Messiah from the cross. How could he deliver them if he couldn't even deliver himself? You see, what they stumbled over, and what they still stumble over today, is that God chose the cross to show his power. Tell the person beside of you, there's power in the cross. It's not the way we think. It's not conventional wisdom. Our wisdom, well, let me write this story. And yes, as they began to put him on the cross, all of a sudden, he called these people down. The cross split apart, and he came out, and he had fire flying from this wrist and fire flying from this wrist, and he consumed all the soldiers, and he stood on the top of the hill in Jerusalem and destroyed them all by fire. That's the way I would write it. That's going to happen later. We wouldn't have wrote it like this, would we? Don't you know the devil thought, finally, they're going to get him. This Son of God, they're going to get him. The devil didn't even know. You see, the Jews were looking for a king like David to be their deliverer. You say, what do you mean? Something interesting you might have missed here. If you go back to your Palm Sunday story, do you remember what they were shouting? Hosanna to the Son of David. You know, David was their most decorated military leader. When David came in as king, he went and conquered, and David had the hand of God on him. People knew this is the David that stood in front of Goliath. This is the David that conquered. This is the David that had strength and power. So they were looking for a Messiah like David who would come and conquer with military power. Because all they saw Rome as was a military power over them. So they were looking for a Messiah that would come in the order of David. This is how all this ties together. They thought Jesus, if he was the Messiah, would have the power of God on him. But they began to disapprove as the crowd began to see that Jesus was being persecuted and he didn't do anything about it. They thought he couldn't, but the truth is, he could, but he chose not to because the real power of God would be displayed at the cross. How much power does it take not to do what you can? I take you back to a story that might spur your memory. In Matthew chapter 26, do you remember when Jesus was in the garden praying? And the soldiers came to take him. And Peter pulled out his sword. And Peter cut off the ear of the guard that came to take him. Do you remember that story? You know what Jesus said to Peter? Put away your sword. Don't you know that if I wanted to, I could pray to God and he would send me 12 legions of angels. You know how many 12 legions is? He was just throwing a number. I could pray to God and he will send me 72,000 angels. Let me tell you what angel strength is. In 2 Kings chapter 19, one angel killed 185,000 men. So do the math. 72,000 times 185,000? Peter, I don't need your sword. If I wanted to, I could call 72,000 angels just to pray to God. I choose not to. That's big. Remember that. Are you in Matthew chapter 26? I heard you turning. Let me read you a couple of verses. This is what these people couldn't get over. This is when Jesus stood in front of the Sanhedrin. These are the religious people, the religious elite. Verse 67 and 68. Then did they spit in his face, and they buffeted him, and others smote him with the palms of their hands, saying, prophesy unto us, thou Christ. Who is he that smote thee? They spit in his face. They beat him with their fists. They slapped him with their hands. They mocked him. They said, if you're Christ, now that we've got you blindfolded, we just spit in your face and slapped you, which one of us did it? If you're Christ, we don't think you're Christ, because if you were Christ, you wouldn't sit here and let us do that. They didn't understand where God was going to show his power. They thought he would show it in brute strength or something like that. As we go to verses, or chapter 27, we read that this crowd that was waving palm branches had finally made themselves in front of Pilate. And as Jesus stood in front of Pilate to be judged, the chief priests and the other religious leaders, well, then they joined the crowd. If you read chapter 27, verse 20, you read this verse. But the chief priests and the elders persuaded the multitude that they should ask Barabbas and destroy Jesus. How do you think they persuaded the multitude? How do you think? If he was the Messiah, let me tell you, would he be letting this happen to him? Would he be letting those people hold him? If he was the Son of God, the Messiah we've been waiting on to, he would have power. How's he going to overthrow the Roman government if they're just holding him there? They persuaded, right? Because it was an issue of power to them. And then if you read on down, verses 26 through 31, you read this and you think, surely if he's the Son of God, he would show his power. It says, and they released Barabbas unto them, and when he had scourged Jesus, he delivered him to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the common hall and gathered unto them the whole band of soldiers, and they stripped him. And they put on a scarlet robe, and when they had plaited a crown of thorns, they put it upon his head, and a reed in his right hand, and they bowed a knee before him, and mocked him, saying, Hail, King of the Jews! And they spit upon him, and took the reed, and smote him in the head. And after that they had mocked him, they took the robe off of him, and put his own raiment back on him, and led him away to crucify him. Surely. If I'm in the crowd that day and I'm thinking about the power that I thought, I'm thinking, surely don't let them do that to you. Surely don't let them spit on you. How can they take that cat of nine tails? Whoosh, whoosh, and every time it hits, it rips those pieces of flesh out. How can they do that if you're the Messiah? How can they mock you with a crown of thorns? How can they slap you in the face with that reed they put in your hand? How can you let them do that? They didn't understand the power of that cross, what led to the cross, and what was going to happen after the cross. That was a stumbling block to them. They had a different idea of what a Savior should be. Surely their Savior, their Messiah, their Deliverer would show His power and be able to escape the cross. You listen to the tone of the crowd as they pass by. Especially, listen in this verse as it says they wagged their heads and insulted Him. In that same book, Matthew 27, listen to verses 36 through 44. And sitting down, they watched him there. They set up over his head his accusation written, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Then were there two thieves crucified with him, on the right and another on the left. They that passed by reviled him, wagging their heads and saying, "Thou that destroyest the temple and buildest in 3 days, save thyself if thou be the Son of God. Come down from the cross." Likewise also the chief priests, mocking him with the scribes and elders, said, "He saved others. Himself he cannot save. If he be the King of Israel, let him come down now from the cross and we will believe him. He trusted in God, let him deliver him now if we will have him. For he said, I am the Son of God." Do you hear everything they're saying? They passed by, they shook their heads as they insulted him. That was the overwhelming theme. That was the hurdle. If he can't save himself, how can he save us? The answer is, they didn't understand the power of God. Jesus showed the power of God by the cross. The power of the cross is that Jesus willingly suffered and died, and God willingly let it happen. It was the will of God that he would be saved, that we would be saved by the power of the cross. You see, it takes more power to let something happen that you know you could have stopped. I love what Jesus says in John 10:11. He says, "I'm the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep." That was a long time before he stood in front of it and had to do it. He knew he was the good shepherd. And then, later on, he goes into detail, verse 17 and 18. He says, "Therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life, that I might take it up again. No man taketh it from me, but I lay it down of myself." Now listen to verses 17 and 18 of John 10. "I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. This commandment have I received of my Father." How cool is that? He knew the power that was to come, right? What do you mean? It was God's will for him to show his power through the cross. It was the power of love. It was the power of humility. It was the power of sacrifice. It was the power of atonement. It was the power of a substitutionary death. It was the power of the resurrection. It was the power of the cross. All that's wrapped up in the cross. That was the Jews' stumbling blocks. Now the Greeks. These are the non-Jews. They're like us. Remember he said we preach the cross, Christ crucified, which is the cross, unto the Jews a stumbling block. But listen, unto the Greeks, foolishness. To everyone else, the cross seemed like foolishness. They saw themselves as intellectuals. They looked for wisdom. We learn that in verse 22 of 1 Corinthians. They look for wisdom. That's why he came back and said, "Where is the wise?" You see, they had studied great intellectual thinkers in that day. Socrates, Plato, Aristotle. Socrates said the secret to a successful society is education. So gain all the wisdom that you can get. We live in a society today that still feels this way. And the problem that with that kind of thinking is not that, and I'm not preaching, hey, don't go out and learn anymore. I'm preaching knowledge is key, but not your intellect. The problem with that way of thinking is that man will never be able to figure out a way to remove his own sin. Never. He may think that he's smart enough to justify his sin by coming up with reasons that his sin isn't wrong, but man has to realize that it takes faith, believing in something that we can't figure out. So why did they think it was foolishness? Well, it was foolish to them. They couldn't believe that logically and reasonably a man could be born of a virgin. That does not make logical sense. They could not believe that God would make himself into a fleshly man. They could not believe by their wisdom that God would let mortal men nail him to a cross. And they did not believe by their wisdom that when a man dies, that he could come back to life. Every bit of that defies wisdom, doesn't it? And the world today is still telling me, hey, you foolish, Shof, you're foolish. And all those people coming over there to listen to you are foolish. I want you to leave here today with your chest out as a child of God saying, hey, the foolish are leaving the building according to you, but we're on our way. Right? God's idea of foolish and man's idea of foolish are different. Because God said, the fool has said in his heart, there is no God. Understand, they couldn't grasp it in their mind, so they didn't believe it and still don't. That's man today. So by reason of their own wisdom and logic and reason, they saw that Jesus and the cross and the way Jesus sacrificed on the cross, they saw all that as foolishness. And by rights, the way they were raised as far as what they believed that man had many gods. And you have your life to be able to do good works and to honor your God. And if you don't, then when you die, you'll be reincarnated as something else and you'll get another chance with another God and you'll be able to honor them, and it can go on and on until you get it right. So why would you need a Savior? And why would someone have to die for you? Doesn't make sense that our God dies for you. We need Him alive. You say, well, He did. Jesus did resurrect. He is alive. But listen, here's the problem. If people don't believe in the cross, they're never going to believe in the resurrection. There's power in the cross. Doesn't this sound like the intellectual world that we live in today? Most everyone thinks that they have the power to save themselves by either doing good works or by creating their own God. That's the new thing. Create your own God that you have inside of you. A God that doesn't require you to go against anything, any fleshly feelings that you have inside of you. I mean, if we have a choice to intellectually develop our own God, don't you know that we'll develop one that fits our own lifestyle and accepts things that we like and things that we accept and that we don't want to change? That's what the world's done today. Do you know that in the past 20 years, people have developed a God that accepts homosexuality as being something that God approves of? In the past 40 years, they've accepted a God that accepts killing unborn children. They've made their own gods. They've accepted gods that allow you to have premarital sex and it's okay. They've accepted a God that says, hey, you can serve me whenever it's convenient to you, and that's their God. You see what we're saying here? If man has a choice to develop his own God, it's definitely not going to be something that goes against what he believes. That's why you have that many different religions around the world today. People have catered that religion to cater to them. You know what I think it's like? I think it's like having a Mr. Potato Head God. I think that's what the world's changed. Hey, I'm going to make God. Here's what I'm going to stick on this here and stick on here. Here's my God. This God lets me be able to do what I want to do. Mr. Potato Head God. That's who they're worshiping. There's a whole sermon in that. I got a God that lets me go to church, but every now and then on the weekend I can slip out and I can just raise immortal, you know what? That's in my potato head God. I got a God that lets me come to church once a week, twice a month. My God allows me to do this and I can get enough to do it. That's my Mr. Potato Head God. I've got a God that lets me be able to act like I want to act. But listen, I've got this time where I slip away on my computer and I go in here and I pour up all this porn site and all this kind of stuff. That's what my God lets me do. And He'll forgive me of it and I'll go back and I'll get started again. I got a God that lets me act like I love my wife and flirt with all these other women whenever I'm not with her. That's a Mr. Potato Head God a lot of people have. I could go on and on and on, right? We develop our own God. That's what the wisdom of the world does. They'll develop their own God. I love what Isaiah said. He says, all of our righteousness is as filthy rags. In closing here, the third way of thinking. You know, the first way was that the Jews saw it as a stumbling block. Why? Because it was not the model they thought their Messiah would be. The second way was the Greeks, and it was foolish to them because they couldn't wrap their mind around it. But the third way of thinking about the cross, I love it. This is 1 Corinthians 1, verse 24. It says, but unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. When Paul was preaching the cross, he was preaching the power of God that you have to accept to save you. Have to. When he says in this verse, Christ is the power of God, Christ here speaks of the crucified Christ. Not just Christ that was born in Bethlehem, that lived in Nazareth, but he says Christ, because understanding the context, if you go back and look at these verses, he's talking about the crucified Christ. Christ here speaks of the crucified Christ. Man's idea of a Savior is that their Savior has power to take others' lives, not have his own life taken. That's what man thinks. My Savior, my God, would be somebody that's powerful enough to conquer everybody, not somebody who would let somebody else crucify them. As far as the Greek, man's idea of a Savior is that he can save himself by his own wisdom. Man's wisdom or intellect never concludes that life can come through death. The wise of this world don't accept Jesus Christ because they can't figure out how somebody could die and it could bring life. But praise God, his power and his wisdom was displayed when Christ, now listen to this power, willingly was persecuted, willingly was mocked, willingly was beaten, willingly was spit on, willingly was led up that hill, willingly took every strap on his back, thinking of your name and my name, willingly. What kind of power does it take to hang there knowing that you could call thousands of angels to deliver you at any time, but you said, no, it's for him, it's for her, it's for him, it's for her. Beat me again, spit in my face, let the blood, let the pain come. That's power to stay. That's the power of the cross. It takes a lot more power to do that than to draw on your other power and just wipe everything out. That's the power that men fail to understand today. It's the power of the cross. Amazing love, right? I can't fathom. He loves you. The power of the cross is the power of his love. Everything that he wanted to show you happened from Pilate's judgment hall, from the court of the Sanhedrin, all the way to the cross. But glory to God. He showed his awesome power when they buried him in that tomb. And he rose again. Everyone that thought he couldn't do it, that day realized, what did we do? Through the ages, man's distorted the story. But today, you get to hear the power of the cross used only with Scripture that came from the Word of God. Today, if you sit here and you realize, well, what do I have to believe? I believe there's a God. You're right. The devil also believes there's a God. That doesn't get him to heaven. I believe Jesus lived. Well, that's not what you have to believe. You have to believe in the power of the cross. What do you mean you have to believe it? You have to basically, and this is why I keep this thing, you have to basically take everything that the cross stands for and you have to accept it. This is what I have. What do you have, Mike? Is it your money that'll get you to heaven? No. Is it my status? No. Is it my good works? No. None of that can get you to heaven. For by grace are you saved through faith. It's not of yourself. What can get you to heaven? The fact that I've accepted the cross. I've accepted the power of the cross. The power of the cross is what saved me. The power of the cross is what saves you. That he died for my sin as a substitutionary lamb. The power of the cross. The power that he chose to stay on the cross. In my own wisdom, I can't understand it. If I had to paint a picture of what a Messiah, a Savior would be, it wouldn't have been that he died. It would have been that he went out and conquered. But God's mind is so much deeper than our minds, and He knew by Him dying, He was conquering the cross, death, hell, and the grave. If you're in this room today and there is any doubt in your mind that you have accepted the cross, then when we have this invitation today, there will be an opportunity for you to know beyond a shadow of a doubt, to know that you know that you know that you've used that power to save you. You're basically praying to God and saying, God, I'm a sinner, and I believe Jesus died for me, and that's the only way that I can get to you. Forgive me of my sins. I want to accept the cross and let Jesus be my Savior. And your life will change, friend. Your life will change. Jesus Christ will come into you. The Spirit of God will indwell you, and you'll have a wisdom that you've never had before. You'll have a peace that passeth all understanding. Don't wait. And child of God, Christian that's here today, are you living with the power of the cross? The only reason that I brought up at the beginning of this sermon that not one person acknowledged the whole work of God that God did whenever I stated it there, from His travel to the cross, to His death on the cross, to His resurrection, not one person said a word. You know why? We've lost the power of the cross. We've lost being excited about the power of the cross. Scarcely would a man die for a righteous man, but for somebody unrighteous, Christ died for me. God commendeth His love toward me and you, that while we were sinners, He sent His Son to show that power on the cross. That's big. Come today. If you're not saved, if you're not sure, I want to pray with you. You can accept the Lord Jesus Christ into your heart today. Accept the power of the cross. And Christian, if you become so distracted in this world that the power of the cross is not something that's getting you excited anymore, you need to hit your knees. You need to realize what a big deal this is. If you live in the power of the cross, there's not too many things that can wipe the shine off your apple. You know that? Stand with me. Father God, I love You and I praise You and I thank You for this day. I pray, God, You speak to us, minister to us. If there's one here that's never accepted Your Son Jesus as their Savior, that today is the day of salvation for them. I pray, Lord, today that You would give such a freedom of the Holy Spirit to move in this service. Lord, that we would see the power of the cross and it would become, Lord, so big in our minds today. We would see the power of Your love, the power of Your sacrifice, the power of Your humility, the power, Lord, of the atoning blood of Jesus Christ. And that power would change us today. I pray, God, for anyone lost, that they would have the courage, Lord, to come and accept what You have and leave with that peace. And I pray, Lord, for all the Christians in this room. Lord, we think power comes in so many other things in our life. And Lord, we've heard what real power is today. I want to live under that power, Lord. So I pray, God, that there are prayers of rededication all over this room today. In Jesus' name, amen. Page 303. We're going to sing one more verse, and we'll sing this last verse. And if the Lord's speaking to you, don't leave here without answering Him back. Let me explain to you. I know I've told you this before, but every sermon, it's a conversation. It's not a conversation between me and you. I'm trying to speak on behalf of God, and I know that He could choose somebody a lot better than me, but it's a conversation between Him and you. He's used His word to impart something to your mind so that it gets from your mind to your heart. Don't leave here today without answering Him back. If you're a Christian, answer Him back. He's your Father. He's trying to tell you you need to live with more of an understanding of His power in your life so you'll quit worrying about those other things that your wisdom is keeping you in bondage of. And if you're lost, He's crying out to you saying, come to Me, come to Me, and I'll in no wise cast you out. Answer Him today. Today is the day you have. You do not have tomorrow. I'm not pressuring you. I'm just trying to bring it to your awareness. It's a conversation. God deserves an answer from you. We'll sing another verse. Thank you for coming today. I appreciate you being here. I appreciate just such a good spirit of God in this place today. And I appreciate Him teaching us through His word and showing us His power. I appreciate the power of the cross. It just goes beyond our imagination. So thank you for being here. I do invite you to come back tonight at 6 o'clock. Enjoy the cantata with us. Choir being here at 4 to go over your last rehearsal. But it's going to be a good time with the Lord. Please come tonight. We'll fellowship together. We'll enjoy this cantata. Invite somebody that you know if they want to hear something neat. So anything that you want to tell them before we leave? Okay. All right. Any other announcements before we leave? The youth are leaving at 6 this evening because they're going to go back to the conference. Any other announcements that we have? Anybody? Anywhere? Tab, will you dismiss us in prayer?
Our gracious Heavenly Father.